Okay, so alumni, let, yeah, yeah, teacher alumni too. You'll get two tickets. So we've got Anna and Alyssa. So let them know if you get one or two tickets, and they'll hand those out while we're getting ready. What's that? Okay, great. And we'll kick off whenever Bev is ready.
I'm going to give them another couple of minutes.
Yeah.
All right?
Okay.
So they can pass those out.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. I'm Babette Huber, the Town and Village of Victor's historian, and I want to welcome you to the Historic Advisory Committee's lecture series. If you have any interest in our historic lectures, there's a paper on the back table. You can sign up, put your email address, and we'll send you information. The next lecture is on Sunday, November 12th, and it is the history of Victor baseball from 1875 to the present with Tim Munn. Then on Sunday, December 10th, it will be Women in Sports, the Impact of Title IX with Norma Wisent. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to Keith Partington. Keith graduated from RIT and worked as a collaborative sales professional at Microsoft Corporation in upstate New York for 28 years. His tenure spanned multiple industries and various citizenship initiatives that support workforce development, diversity, and education. Since 2018, Keith has leveraged his broad sales, marketing, and technology skills as a nonprofit freelancer to help with projects focused on accessibility and inclusion. He's a member of the Landmark College Advisory Council. He volunteers in the Canal and Community PAL Inclusion Program for Rochester Accessible Adventures. He's a board member of the Victor Central Schools Educational Foundation since its inception, and he leads its Alumni Connections Committee. And Keith also has a novel, which I'm sure you'll talk about in a little while.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Oh, thank you. Thanks, Babette. I'd like to thank Babette and the Victor Historical Committee for inviting us and putting this series together. I attended the Ewing Race Team event in the spring. It was fabulous. And I watched Babette's barn session on YouTube, and we'll be streaming live on YouTube today, so this will be available for others to watch. And we have the two alumni that'll follow me, Tim and Norma. And Tim's fabulous, he's an author. And Norma helped us with the Title IX, the 50th year anniversary of Title IX. So she'll be speaking on that. We've done some articles on that. So I know both of those are gonna be fabulous sessions. I'd like to thank Susie for coming in on her day off and running some technology here. So we've got the latest and greatest at Victor. So as you can see, we're going to cover today the VCS time machine, I call it. And I got that idea because I do a lot of alumni articles. And when I go back through the Democrat and Chronicle and the yearbooks and things, it really is like going back through a time machine. So I did think about coming up with a backstory that talked about maybe some teenagers that were fishing by Mud Creek on Plaster Mill, and they found the old gypsum mine and found some blue and gold everlasting rocks. And then, of course, Turner Automotive, Tom did confirm they sold a DeLorean once. I was going to tie that into a whole story, but we've got so much material to cover today. I'll leave that for another day and time. But anyway, a lot of history in Victor, and as you can see, the different points of the yearbooks correspond with, in the upper left, the original Victor school on campus, and you can see the growth that goes through 2020. That's 1940 to 2020. Interesting that as the growth happened, the yearbooks got thicker, but towards the last maybe 10 or 15 years, the pictures actually get smaller. So the yearbooks are actually the same size. So the last 10 or 15 years, like a football pitcher is about this big instead of a whole page. And we're going to take a look. We're going to go back through time in our time machine in a minute. So that's what we're here to do today. Agenda, we're going to talk a little bit about, we already talked about me. We're going to get a little bit of a hands up about you just to make sure we're on track. Then we're going to do a video. It's about a 6-minute video, but it kind of recaps 70 years of yearbooks, so that'll be fun. And then we'll touch on just the history of yearbooks in general. And then we have another special treat, which the class of, I think it was 2018, did a history of the bagel. So we recreated a little video with their history, and we'll watch that. And Babette has a fabulous article. If you haven't been on the town historic site website, she's got a history of the bagel up there she had written too. And that goes into much deeper detail. And we're fortunate that three students helped me put this together and told stories over time. So we have Mrs. Bow, Jenner Davis, who's here today, and Xander Roaring talked about the different stages in history of putting the yearbook together. It's gotten easier with cell phones, I can tell you that much. And then before Bagel, I've worked on some stories, like for Mrs. Corey. Well, if there's no yearbook, how do you put those stories together? I'm going to show you some resources that we have available, so you can go back before 1948. Just touch on alumni resources, and we're going to cap off. We're going to take the time machine back to the future and think about students when they graduate thinking about their future. We're going to take a look at some VCS students and what they've ended up doing in their careers. So it's a packed agenda, and I have a homework assignment. We'll save that for the end. All right, let's see if we've got, we're going to experiment with running these videos. Did it come up? Okay. That's just a little more about me. And by the way, my hats today, I'm on the Victor Alumni Banquet Association Committee. I started working on that. So we'd love to see you all in the spring at that. And then I manage alumni connections for the Victor Central School Foundation, which we started about 8 years ago with some alumni. And if you don't know, we raise money to help with things that aren't possible in the school budget. So we're really excited about that. So that's more about me. I am a recent grandfather, so we're excited about that. And as you can see, the only reason I'm here today is because the Bills are playing at night. Otherwise, this might have been iffy. So anyway, more about you. How many alumni did we have? And alumni includes now staff, alumni staff. Okay, excellent. Do we have any veterans or first responders in the room? Okay, so we're going to give 2 more tickets to each of these gentlemen. We'd like to thank them for their service. So Alyssa, give them each 2 more tickets. All right. Yep, and two more over here with Babette. Thank you. Do we have any healthcare workers? Okay. So you'll get an extra ticket. All right. Yeah. Retired healthcare workers, yes. So keep your hands up, and Alyssa's going to give out a few more tickets. And then while she's doing that, how many of you live in the greater Farmington? Go ahead, Allison. Oh, yeah, for the ticket, yep. Yeah, keep your hands up. How many live in the Victor Farmington or adjacent community now? Okay. How many of you that have your hands up left and came back? Okay, great. So that gives me a feel. And like our alumni that we track, they're around the globe now, which is interesting. Some have left, some have come back. I think that about covers it. That helps me think about who you are today when we pattern the talk. So we're going to go ahead and roll the first video. Take a look. This is the VCS time machine.
Up in the morning and out to school. The teacher is teaching the golden rule. American history and practical math. You study them hard and hoping to pass. Working your fingers right down to the bone. And the guy behind you won't leave you alone. goes the bell. The cook in the lunchroom's ready to sell. You're lucky if you can find a seat. You're fortunate if you have time to eat. Back in the classroom, open your books. Keep it, the teacher don't know how mean she looks. Soon as 3 o'clock rolls around, you finally lay your burden down. Close up your books, get out of your seat. Down the halls and into the street. Up to the corner and round the bend. Right to the juke, John, you go in. Drop the coin right into the slot. You gotta hear something that's really hot. With the one you love, you're making romance. All day long you've been wanting to dance. Feeling the music from head to toe. Round and round and round you go. When some loud bragger tries to put me down and says this school is great, I tell him right away, now what's the matter, buddy? Ain't you heard of my school? It's number one in the state.
Hey, hey, take it away. Get
so
ball and fight.
To your school. For football and track, I'm proud to wear it now. When I cruise around the other parts of the town, I got my decal and band. So be true to your school, just like you would to your girl. On the football game, and I'll be ready to fight. We're gonna smash it now. My girl will be working on her pom poms now, and she'll be yelling tonight. So be true to your school.
Another turning point, a fork stuck in the road. Time grabs you by the wrist, directs you where to go. So make the best of this test and don't ask why. It's not a question but a lesson learned in time. It's something unpredictable, but in the end is right. I hope you had the time of your life. So take the photographs and still frames in your mind, hanging on a shelf in good health and good time. Tattoos and memories and dead skin on trial. For what it's worth, it was worth all the while. It's something unpredictable, but in the end is right. I hope you had the time of your life. Something unpredictable, but in the end that's right. I hope you had the time of your life. It's something unpredictable, but in the end is right. I hope you had the time of your life.
All right, that's a quick time machine review. Challenges is to be representative of all the new things that happened as the school grew. So we tried to throw in both the culture and the styles, and then also different clubs, sport teams as they came on board. It's really difficult to represent over 70 years, but it was really fun going back through. We're going to see if we can flip forward now to the next slide. Great. So think about the history of yearbooks. Let's take a step back. The history of yearbooks, in a sense, started in the Roman Empire with stone slabs of warriors. And that was kind of the first known set of yearbooks that documented a class of something. And then there were proto-yearbooks in the form of scrapbooks in Eastern schools around the 17th century. But the first formal yearbook, of course, came from an Ivy, came from Yale, and they had an 1806 sort of a class yearbook. But then it became mainstream, like any technology, in the sense that Otto Josten, who was a jewelry repairman, created a memorabilia company. So yearbooks really took off from that point, and we owe him and his company a debt of thanks. And then generation after generation have now enjoyed not only yearbooks, but class rings, and soon maybe a Super Bowl ring in this area. But for now, I wouldn't put up a Patriots ring, so I went with the New York Giants, even though they beat us. But Mr. Josten and his company really kicked off what became that mainstream opportunity, and we're thankful for that. And in the sense that today, Josten's, if you go out to their website, there's so many tools that they have for students to put the yearbook together. So very exciting. And of course, our first yearbook, 1948. Now, there are some disclaimers because there's some yearbooks. I have a near-perfect collection that have been donated. And when you go through them, they're not my yearbooks. So sometimes there literally is profanity, and there are some inappropriate comments. So I tried to make sure any yearbooks we brought didn't have those. If they do, I apologize. It is interesting to see some of these because they were all donated. So anyway, I'm going to pass this around.
This is the 1948. And Mrs. Zumbo was actually class of 48. I didn't get to her, but if you have questions and you see her, ask her about that first yearbook.
And we're going to roll another video. Now, this is representative of a story that the class of 2018 did about the yearbook. It's a little shorter than yours, so we made a little digital documentary. Let's take a look at the video.
For many years, the bagel has been a way for students to reflect back on the memories, smiles, and laughs of the school year. It provides as a physical, long-lasting memento that keeps high school memories safe. Without the bagel, how exactly would we look back on these cherished memories? The bagel was just an idea in 1947 when Mr. Corbett, a teacher at the school, approached Mrs. Berry, another teacher at the high school, with the idea to start a yearbook. Mrs. Berry, excited by the idea, eagerly began as the supervisor of the first ever yearbook. With the first interest meeting drawing the attention of nearly 30 kids, the creation of the bagel was on its way. Moving into 1948, the first ever yearbook began to near completion. The yearbook captured the essence of the school, including school spirit, high academic standards, and of course the beginning of the yearbook. But with the releasing of the yearbook came the need for a name. What would the yearbook be called? The name came with the desire to capture Victor High School as an institution education and the school spirit, Mrs. Berry said. Though she cannot remember, Mrs. Berry believes the naming of the yearbook took place through a contest which helped them stumble on the name, Blue and Gold Everlasting. The staff took the first letters of each of the words, creating the name Bagel. The accent was then added for a little flair and, of course, to keep the yearbook from being confused with the popular breakfast food. So, in the spring of 1948, the bagel made its first-year debut to the 7th through 12th graders of Victor Central Schools. The bagel has evolved over the years, but 70 years ago to now, the yearbook still brings the same joy to high schoolers as they flip through recounting their memories from the year, all the times that brought them joy, all the remembrance that they will not forget.
Great, so with that, we're off and running at Victor. We've got our first yearbook. And we'll, yeah, that's okay. We'll, yeah, we'll jump ahead. I think that happens to me sometimes too. That's perfect. So we thought we'd work with three students that were involved in the yearbook over time and get their stories. Again, we have Mrs. Bo, Frances Kara, who also did an article this past fall about Title IX. She helped us with a story in the Victor Alumni newsletter. We talked to her. Nina went over with the yearbooks and actually spent some time and got some comments. We also worked with another student who was from the 50s, and they said, "I have no recollection. I know it was fun. But I have no recollection of that time." So we jumped to 1989, and then Jenner and some of her student colleagues gave us some feedback on what it was like to put it together in 89. Again, pre-digital, so you're taking pictures and developing them. And then Xander, fortunately, and they put together that history of the bagel, they had digital cameras. So we'll talk a little bit about each one and how the yearbook got put together. Mrs. Bo said that the seniors worked on the yearbook in 1948. That was the first trend. And then she recalls how exciting it was as a junior for them to work on that and then deliver it. So she joined the yearbook committee in 1948. And she remembers it was such a small class. It was so easy to keep track of things, take pictures, do the photo layouts. And they really had a lot of fun working on the 1949 yearbook. She also, going back with Nina through the yearbooks, she remembers it was so much fun being at Victor, and she was involved in so many activities, from school band to cheerleading to the yearbook team. She was a drum majorette, and she really enjoyed that. And what we found with the students we worked with, they were involved in so many things, and yet they donated their time to create the yearbook. And that might be a trend for the ones that worked on it. They just had that energy and the passion to bring us the yearbook. So we jump ahead to Jenner. I'm going to cover a couple bullets, but we'll see if you want to make a comment or two. But if you do, I have to have you come to the mic because we're streaming. Jenner's colleague remembered at that time they could go to a U of R summer camp. So a few of them went to to kind of get acclimated and how to put the yearbook together. Another person remembered had to borrow an electric typewriter. Now, is there anybody in the room that's never used a typewriter, a physical typewriter? Melissa, have you used one? Anna? No. So think about that. They literally had to use a typewriter. They had to have all the photos. They had to lay those out. And Mr. Cole, remember Mr. Cole, who was also the photography teacher? He worked very closely with the students to take all the pictures, develop them, and then bit by bit put together the layout with the students' names and things. And then what, of course, happens when you work with a typewriter, for those of us who are used them, you make a mistake. What do you have to do to the layout? You have to start all over, put a new page in. So think about how tedious it was to put the yearbook together. Another of Jenner's student colleagues remembers she loved working on the senior superlatives, and they worked really, really hard, believe it or not, on that piece to get the photos, the creative photos available, but then more importantly, the voting, making sure that they had the proper votes to see who actually won. And those are a fun part, and they kind of weave in and out. Some years had them, some didn't, but it's one of my favorite parts of the yearbook. So Jenner talked about really the biggest cost of a yearbook is labor, and it's pretty much the student advisors and the student labor. And there were some interesting stories they recalled. Have you ever gone back through a yearbook and there's the soccer pitcher and somebody has a shirt on, and then you look in the back of the yearbook, there's a candid and they have the same shirt on? Remember that labor and logistics? It means that sometimes you took multiple photos in the same day, and so people had the same clothing on. So when you're going back through a yearbook and you notice that, that was the reason for it. They also remember from Jenner's team, really the deadline pressures, and towards the end, finishing that layout, it really does get to the point they work so hard, and then time starts closing on the end of the year. So they have to really work hard to pull it together. I asked Jenner for a quote, "Why did you join the yearbook committee?" And she said, "There's nothing I didn't join." And she said she was interested in so many things. And really, that's a great opportunity to develop skills and experiences for students that worked on it, especially for this, putting together a really long project on a tight timeline. And an interesting story from Jenner came up. Not only did she learn new skills and experiences, but she ended up going out to get business sponsors to cover some of the costs of the yearbook, and she met with a local business person whose son went to Cornell, and after talking to him, it turns out that is the school that she applied to and ended up attending. So think about the connections of working on this big student project and all the things that they got back out of that for all the hard work they put in. Anything to add? Jenner made a note for those who can't hear. If she'd known the 80 hairdo was going to be in there, she might have pulled the idea. But no, it's very interesting to also go through again the styles and the cultures over time. And of course, we have some retired school teachers here, and it must just be so fabulous when you go back and look through all the fun, because you've been through multiple generations. All right, well, we jump forward now. As you noted, the first digital camera that had a phone or a phone that had a camera was in 2000. So now we jump forward to Xander Roering. He works up at the Chamber of Commerce now. He graduated in 2018. And the interesting thing is that the closer we got to today, the more they remember about working on the project, which is an interesting idea. So anyway, that's their picture. And at the bottom, that's his parents' submission of the picture. They had about 10 to 17 students that worked on it, but mainly it was about 10. And they worked with Mr. Denner, Mrs. Zolo, and Mrs. Duckworth. And I think Justin's, he said, has gotten it down to 4 phases. And you work on each phase, and you complete it, and you move on to the next. So again, with technology advancing, so did the process for delivering a yearbook. But he estimates that the first 3 phases production, it's about 400 or 500 hours of student time and staff time, which is amazing. He did make the comment that smartphones made it much easier, because the real hard thing for a yearbook team is to capture inclusive and diverse photos of everybody. And all three teams talked about it was really important to try to get as many candidates and as many people. And he said what they do, they broke up into teams. So if you were in marching band, you were going to get some pictures. And if you were in the freshman class, you were going to get some pictures. And about halfway through the year, they went through the class list, and they double-checked it to see who hadn't they got pictures of. And believe it or not, this is so cool, they created a new list. These are the people we still have to get pictures of. So it's really important that everybody's represented in the yearbook, and they really do work hard to do that. I think the idea is some use themes now. Jostens will actually give you themes, but most students choose not to use it. He said they didn't either. They were so creative, they wanted to create their own theme. One of the biggest lessons he learned, and this is important as you go out in the world of work or in the military, you can't please everyone. So if you're on the yearbook committee, he said you want it to be perfect at the beginning, but you realize you can't please everyone. And he told a funny story that after the yearbook was out, he had designed the cover. He was really proud of it. He was with a group of students after the yearbook got delivered. And it was really important. They don't really share much of the theme of the yearbook till the day it comes out. So they're sitting around with a group of like 15 students. And one of his female classmates said, "I just don't like the cover. It's horrible." And so he kind of swallowed his pride. And then she goes, "Oh, wait a minute. Didn't you work on the cover?" He goes, "Yeah, actually, I did." She goes, "Oh, I'm so sorry. I love the cover." So that was one of the funny stories he recalls. He also has a family connection. His mother was the editor in charge for her yearbook. And then when he was a sophomore, his sister was the editor at Victor. So they sort of have a family tradition. And it said it really helped him take over the leadership role for that. One of the things he also talked about, and you'll notice in some of the yearbooks, it started with the bagel and then a theme like, what was your theme, Jenner? It was, actually it's on, Remember When. And then some yearbooks have the theme and bagel. And he said that was a hard decision. They had gotten rid of doing bagel with the theme and they brought it back for his yearbook. And he said, a lot of the students didn't like it because the joke was, why is our yearbook named after a food? Bagels have gotten very popular. I'm going to pass a couple of these around. This is the first all color. I'm going to go back. And while we're all here together, I'm going to ask you all to give us a round of applause for not only the three students that helped, but all the students over the years that helped with the yearbook. Thank you so much. And for those that Mrs. Bo couldn't be here, she's on vacation, they'll get to watch the video and wanted to make sure they know that we're appreciative of all the hard work that students did. So I work on a lot of alumni articles for the foundation. So what do you do before bagel? What do you do in 1948? And Babette has been a big help. So I actually have a subscription to the Democrat and Chronicle. So I can go back and pull stories and articles from the Democrat and Chronicle. And you wouldn't believe, when you go back to like 1920, simple things like stories about the students, not just sports, are in the Democrat and Chronicle and pictures. So it's a great way to capture that history before the bagel. The Daily Messenger, and I go to CCFL, or FLCC, to pull those stories, and you get those in the library. So those are the years that you can pull stuff from FLCC. And then, and Alyssa, do we have any tickets left? Okay. Then, Victor Herald, here at the town in our history archives, we have all the Victor Heralds. The problem is they're very difficult to read, but you can go out to Fulton and search for articles, so we've used some of that. And then the Victor Records Office at the high school also has a copy of the DVD with all the old Victor Herald articles. So I have a question. Anybody recognize anybody in the upper right-hand corner of the basketball team? Can you give me a name? If so, we'll give you another ticket. It's the 1931 girls basketball team in Victor. All right, does anybody know someone named Kay from Victor? Kay Cotton?
Yeah.
Does anybody recognize their mother? Oh, we're gonna give a ticket to you because we got Kay Cotton's mom is actually in that basketball team. And it's an interesting story. When we did the history of Title IX, we went through the yearbooks and we thought that the first Victor girls basketball team was in 71. But the fact is, we actually had a basketball team in the late 20s into the 30s, and they were champions. So that's the kind of thing you pick up in the newspaper. All right. You got more tickets, Alyssa?
Yeah.
All right. We got one in the back. Okay. Does anybody recognize in the bottom right the woman in the middle? Okay, Vera Brown. Got a ticket over here, Alyssa. All right. So there's stories about Vera Brown that just aren't in the yearbook, but we can capture those. And then this is a giveaway, but Mr. and Mrs. Corey, we worked on some articles with them, so we pulled some story. Did anybody know the story about Mrs. Corey was in the original class at Cuca College, the nursing program that actually became like the U.S. Corps of Nurses for the military? And she was chosen to model the nurse's uniform that was used on a national campaign. So we're gonna see in a minute all the great history of all the students and staff that have worked here, but there's so many fascinating stories. And if you have stories, get them to me and we post a weekly story on LinkedIn, so we'd be happy to publish those stories. Questions on the archives? Okay. How about a little trivia? All right. And then what we'll do is, I don't think we're going to give out tickets for this. How are we doing on time? Okay, great. What was the first year that just shouted out, if you know, first? 48, very good. What was the first hardcover edition? Anybody? 53. back here. What was the first girls athletic team in the yearbook, what year? And I gave it away, it was the basketball team. Well, that wasn't in the yearbook, but that, yep. 71. First color photo in a yearbook. Anybody? 76, I'll accept, because they did a special set of drawings that were of the bicentennial, was it? The 200th year or something. So there was a 14-page piece in there in color. But the first color picture was in 1977, believe it or not. First all-color yearbook, I just passed that around. 2003. Okay, just quickly, VCS alumni resources, because we want to share one last video. There's an amazing group of resources that we work with, the school's records office, the alumni program through the school, through the community relations program, through Victor Education Foundation, we have resources. So if you're ever working on something that involves alumni and you need our help, or you have ideas, let us know. And we're gonna roll one last video. This is the reverse algorithm of the time machine. This would be students thinking about what happens to me in the future. Let's take a look at what happens to Victor students when they leave.
You're the engine that makes all things go. And you're always in disguise, my hero. I see your light in the dark, smile in my face when we all know it's hard. There's no way to ever pay you back. Bless your heart, no, I love you for that. Honest and selfless, don't know if this helps it, but good job. You're doing a good job, a good job. You're doing a good job, don't get too down. The world needs you now. Know that you matter, 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 yeah. You're doing a good job, a good job. You're doing a good job, don't get too down. The world needs you now. Know that you matter, 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 yeah. Six in the morning, as soon as you walk through that door, everyone needs you again. The world's out of order. It's not a sound when you're not around. All day on your feet, hard keep that energy. I know when it feels like the end of the road, you don't let go, you just press forward. You're the engine that makes all things go. Always in disguise, my hero. I see a light in the dark. Smile in my face when we all know it's hard. There's no way to ever pay you back. Bless your heart, no, I love you for that. Honest and selfless. I don't know if this helps it, but good job. You're doing a good job, a good job, good job. You're doing a good job, don't get too down. The world needs you now. Know that you matter, matter, matter. Yeah, it's a good job. You're doing a good job, a good job,
good job.
You're doing a good job,
don't get too down. The world needs you now.
That's a video we've used with students when they graduate. We invite them to join our alumni network. So we put that together. It's pretty representative of the amazing things that happen at Victor. And so the yearbook really is that the essence of what captures the memories, all the friendships, the skills, the experiences, the opportunities that take you forward to your career. So we're thankful that yearbooks were invented and created. And we're thankful for all the people that worked on yearbooks. Whoop, there we go. And again, if you want more details, there's a great article on the Bagel that's up on our town website that Babette did. And if you have any stories that you'd like to share, we'd be happy to write those up and get them out to the different alumni connection groups. So we have a homework assignment. Everybody ready? All right, homework assignment number one. Enjoy a yearbook with some family and friends in the next month. Just sit down, pull out a yearbook, and take some time to look through it. Not just yourself, pick a friend or a family member to go through it. Number two, sign up for some of the alumni resources. Now on the table on the side, and we'll be here for a minute, on the left are the alumni resources. You can take the little flyer, and it talks about how to connect to the different alumni resources. And on the right is a little connector to our Victor Education Foundation. Again, that helps raise money for things that aren't available through the school district. And then we have representative of the 70 years, all the yearbooks starting with 48, 58, 68. I'll stay as long as you want if you want to glance through some of the yearbooks. Questions? And I'll repeat it for those that are watching online. Any questions? Go ahead, Babette.
Graduate from Victor. In Victor, my kids graduate. Always
Okay.
We
Right. Yeah. All right. Well, we learned something new today. Thank you so much. So the question was, is it pronounced bagel, which leads to that students thinking this is a breakfast food, and it's bagel, blue and gold, everlasting.
And that's the
function. Okay. That's great. We're going to carry that forward in any future presentations. Thank you, Babette.
I also think that if the students don't know what bagel means.
Yeah.
Well,
thankfully, the town now, through Susie, is with technology, is streaming, and will this be available on the website? So we're going to pump it out to a lot of the Facebook forums. And then I'll work with the school to actually maybe do a version of this each year up at the school. So we'd be happy to get the word out. Yeah, it's a great idea. Questions? All right, let's see. Do we have anything left? I think that's it. So again, I'd like to thank the town, Babette, the Victor Historical Committee for putting this on. I guarantee that Tim Munn's session on the history of baseball in Ontario County will be excellent, and I guarantee Norma's session is going to be great. Again, when you see our alumni up on the screen, you know that when you come to a presentation that Babette puts on with alumni, it's going to be top-notch. So thank you all for participating. And again, we'll be here for a while if you want to take a look through some of the yearbooks. Thank you. Now, I think we're going to terminate the feed and we're going to do the raffle. How's that sound, Susie? Okay.
Let's see how we did here. Now, there's really no first prize or second prize. The winner gets to choose.